Okay, we're going to get started here.
I'll talk to you after.
Again, for those of you who came in late, my name is Michael Noonan. I'm the Managing Director of the Program on National Security at the Foreign Policy Research Institute. Delighted to have the panel that we have here today. Our first Foreign Fighters Conference, basically we looked at very functional issues. We looked at the phenomenon itself, how it started, definitional issues, and then we kind of looked at functional areas, whether it was source countries, defense threat, or defense finance threat, economic impact of foreign fighters, and then we did one case study on Syria. So I thought this time around it would be better to sort of get, sort of have kind of a roundup on recent trends with this first panel, and then kick off and go into more focused case studies after that. And today I'm delighted we have an exceptional panel. Unfortunately, my good friend and colleague Barack Mendelson originally was supposed to serve on this panel, but he had a family emergency, so unfortunately he's not with us here today. But with that said, we have an exceptional panel. Stephanie Kaplan, to my right and your left, is at MIT. She's finishing up her doctoral dissertation. She's also had fellowships with the Center for Strategic and International Studies. To her right is Marc Sageman. Marc is a very well-known author and analyst and practitioner in this area, from his work with the task force in the 1980s. He's also affiliated with the Foreign Policy Research Institute. To his right is Lorenzo Vidino. He actually deserves an award. I had emailed him last week hoping to get another person to replace Barack, and Lorenzo told me that he was actually in Italy at the time interviewing jihadis, and he came back early just to be here today, so very thankful for that. And then last but not least is Clint Watts. He has a very interesting background. You can all see in the packets that you have before you the bios. Clint is a former Army officer, but also a former FBI special agent. So he has a very unique insight. He's written a lot on this, particularly if you go to the Small Wars Journal. He's written some really first-rate pieces on this. We are going to go alphabetically here, Steph actually asked if she could kick off, so we'll start off. Steph.
We'll see if that was a good idea in a second. Well, first of all, I just wanted to say good morning, and I wanted to thank Mike and FPRI for hosting this conference. He just mentioned that they had one last year, so that's two conferences on this topic in 2 years, which means as an institution, you guys are really ahead on this issue, and I just wanted to thank you for that, and thank you for allowing me to be a part of it. My remarks today are based on my dissertation research that I've been doing for several years, and my dissertation is called The Jihad Effect, and it examines the causes and consequences of the Muslim foreign fighter phenomenon. And so in contemplating how to distill several years of research into 10 minutes, I decided that I'd limit my remarks by presenting three kind of big conceptual arguments that I hope will organize and frame the discussion for the next 2 days. The first argument that I want to make is that contemporary terrorism research is too terrorism-centric, and that war is the most profitable lens through which to view the global jihadist movement. The second point that I'd like to make is that this thing that we call a foreign fighter problem is actually several problems, and that it's a series of puzzles that mirror the life cycle of the foreign fighter phenomenon. The third and final point that I want to make in getting back to the topic of this panel and the conference is that in order to not only react to trends but anticipate trends, we need a conceptual framework to understand this problem so that we're not doing descriptive and ad hoc analysis, but kind of conceptual analysis of these cases and of this problem across time and space. And so I'm going to offer that briefly in conclusion. So going back to the first point about war as a lens of analysis, I strongly believe that we need to view the global jihadist movement less through the lens of terrorism and more through the lens of war. And you just simply can't tell the story of Al-Qaeda without talking about war. The late sociologist Charles Tilly once argued that war made the state and state made war, and I believe that the same logic holds true for the global jihadist movement. War made the movement when its vanguard, Al-Qaeda, emerged during the Soviet-Afghan War, as we all know. And likewise, for the past three decades, the movement has made war through a transnational cause of Muslim foreign fighters in over a dozen conflicts across three different continents. So given the prominence of war in the history of this movement, it's no coincidence that the people who viewed Al-Qaeda and viewed the movement through the lens of war early on were able to accurately predict these inchoate threat in the early 90s. And one great example of this is the intelligence analyst Gina Bennett, who wrote a memo in 1993. It was published in 93 after the First World Trade Center attack. She actually wrote it before the First World Trade Center attack, and it's called The Wandering Mujahideen, Armed and Dangerous. And in this memo, she forecasted the trajectory of the movement and said things like, the U.S. interests would increasingly become targets for violence from the former Mujahideen. And the memo is just five pages, but it's remarkable for its prescience. And so when you read documents like that, you have to ask, why did she get it so right so early? It was before we even knew Al-Qaeda existed. Was she lucky, or was she onto something? And I think she was onto something, because she was using war as a critical explanatory variable through which to view this problem. Two other quick observations to corroborate this point. The first is that more violent Islamic extremists participate in the movement through war than through terrorism. And I tried to do a quick back of the envelope calculation of this. It's not going to be perfect. But we know that at least tens of thousands of Mujahideen have participated in wars, the 16 or so different wars since the 1980s. And looking at the GTD database based out of the University of Maryland, there have been about 71 Al-Qaeda or Al-Qaeda-affiliated attacks since the 1980s. These are attacks, transnational attacks, not in theater, but outside of the theater. And if I was really generous and I said maybe there were 50 unique conspirators per attack, that means there are about 3,500 conspirators versus the tens of thousands of people that we know to have participated in jihad over the years. And that's a pretty striking difference, even though I know it's not accurate. It's a pretty striking difference to think that we carefully focus on the perpetrators of attacks so much when we think about this problem, but the vast majority of the people that are participating in the movement are doing it another way. And so I think perhaps this is because we're guilty of mirror imaging. We're looking at the enemy the way we're assuming that they have the same priorities that we do. And so I think that that's one reason why we should use war as a lens of analysis. Another reason is based on some of the archival work I've done over the summer at the Conflict Records Research Center, which just opened at NDU. I know I'm not the only person on this panel and definitely at this conference to get my hands into the Harmony documents, but I'll just make one brief observation, which is that the vast majority of these documents focus on concepts of guerrilla warfare, weapons and inventory that have to deal with traditional armed conflict versus terrorism. And I actually had to work really, really hard reading over thousands of pages of documents to find things that focus specifically on terrorism. So when you look at these documents, when you look at the paper record that these actors have created, not knowing that we would have access to them one day, they're really focused a lot more on war than terrorism. And that does not mean in any way that terrorism is not a priority for them, that we should not care about terrorism. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that counterintuitively, if we were to study the problem through the lens of war, we would understand a lot more about the problem of terrorism. So moving on to the second point, I think that, like I said before, the foreign fighter problem is not just one problem, it's a series of problems. And from a heuristic perspective, it's really, I think, helpful to organize our thoughts and our discussion according to the foreign fighter life cycle. And that life cycle has three different parts. The first is the pre-war mobilization, the part when people are thinking about going to war, deciding to go to war, and end up at the battlefield. The second stage is obviously the war stage. They're participating in war. And then the third stage is the post-war period. If they die or they demobilize or they move on to another jihad or they engage in some other type of post-war activist activity. And so each of these phases has different puzzles and questions associated with it. The first phase has, during the mobilization phase, we can look at the individual level and say, why are these people doing this? What is the process by which they decide to go? And I'm sure there are lots of other questions that people at this table have thought about. So the second phase is having to do with the role they play in war. Do they have an impact on the outcome? How do they organize when they get there? What do they learn when they get there? Who do they meet when they get there? So all the things that happen on the battlefield. And then the third phase has to deal with what happens to these people after they leave. And what kinds of activities do they get involved in? And then most importantly, how do the consequences in the third phase relate to these first two phases? So I think it's important to kind of break our discussion down and be very conscious of where we are in that life cycle when we're talking about this problem, because often there's a lot of lane changing when we're talking about the foreign fighter phenomenon, and I think it's just because it's not a very organized discussion, and so hopefully I'll lend a little bit of order to that. Third and finally, because I'm sure I'm running out of time, I just wanted to talk about what I think are the best way to deal with trends in this when thinking about this problem. And part of the reason that's animating this, the point that I'm about to make, is that I think too much of this discussion for too long has been focused on ad hoc case study analysis. It's been very descriptive and very reactionary. And of course, the goal here in counterterrorism policy is to be predictive and not reactionary, but act in advance. And so in order to do that, we need a framework to think about the problem. And I think when we're thinking about wars and how they impact the jihadist terrorist threat, the easiest thing that we can get some traction on is by looking at the capabilities that wars generate. Threat is a combination of intention and capabilities, basic definition. And keeping intentions constant, we can look at threats and how they evolve by looking at the capabilities that are generated during the course of a war, whether they be operational capabilities that enable the movement or different organizations within the movement to attack more or attack more often or attack with more lethality, or we can look at organizational capabilities that give the movement fuel, that allow it to survive and thrive. So I think that each war generates these types of capabilities, and if we look at the problem through this framework, not only can we accurately assess what's going to happen in wars, but we can compare and contrast the difference between different cases, which I think is really important, because not all of these cases are uniform. Not all of these cases are going to generate the same effects. And so hopefully by tracing the capabilities that are generated during the course of the war, we can understand what happens as a consequence as well.
Marc?
That's it.
Did I go on that long?
No, but where's the frame?
Where's the framework? Do you want me to respond, or should we wait?
You have a couple minutes, actually, so if
okay.
You want to,
okay.
You can.
Well, the framework is essentially a framework that traces the capabilities during the course of the war. And there are two, and I didn't want to get too involved in this, but there are two mechanisms that I see generating capabilities. The first is a simulation mechanism, which basically says that, you know, these things that happen during wartime are actually, these capabilities that are generated during wartime are actually very similar to the capabilities that you would need as a terrorist. So learning to have good operational security during wartime is something that you would need to have as a terrorist as well. So that's one mechanism showing that how capabilities are generated. They go to war and then they transfer these dual use capabilities to the post-war period. The other mechanism is identification. And I think that the best way to describe it briefly is that, you know, wars are not happening in a vacuum, that things are happening outside of the battlefield while they're happening on the battlefield. And we have to acknowledge the effect of the war outside the battlefield as well. And so, as you know, and I'm sure you'll tell me better in a moment, you know, the propaganda that's used to mobilize resources off the battlefield pulls on this on a Muslim identity that is really showing how they need to identify with the people that are on the battlefield and react to it in a way that they would mobilize either themselves personally or resources in addition to that. So,
okay,
have at it.
Thanks. I mean, you know, just kind of left us hanging there.
I didn't mean to. I thought I was running out of time, but I appreciate it.
All right. I'm looking at this from a different point of view because I'm interested in, you know, in something different. Namely, I'm interested in political violence in the West. So, you know, the foreign fighter phenomenon is really only interesting to me as a result of the potential bleed out from those conflict. And I'm really talking mostly about Westerners going to zones of conflict and perhaps coming back. So is this bleed out problem significant? Well, one answer is of course it is. You know, Al-Qaeda was generated as from the Afghan-Soviet conflict, really mostly foreign fighters, really foreign supporters who became foreign fighters there, and people who had much too good a time fighting the Soviets that their departure made them think, gee, what next? So they created this organization, Al-Qaeda, to carry on the fight. But this, so in a sense, the Afghan war did create this, what I call global neo-jihadi terrorism. And this, I'm talking about violence in the West. Now, the metaphor of the wandering mujahideen, is that right? Well, let's look at it. I want to distinguish between two concepts. One is the concept of foreign fighter, which is a foreigner fighting in a local war, which is not his own country. And the other is the foreign trained fighter, meaning somebody going to another area, usually a sanctuary, being trained but not fighting in that war, and coming back and doing things in his own country. All right. So if, by my count, in terms of global neo-jihadi terrorism in the West, there were about 70 plots so far over about 20 years, and I say in the West. Now, I want to distinguish something else, namely people, you know, tend to overgeneralize from the concept of foreign fighters an abstraction. It turns out that the majority of the foreign fighters in Afghanistan were Pakistani. After that, they were Uzbeks. After that, they were probably Tajiks, and then Saudis, and then, you know, you can see. And the foreign fighter phenomenon, because you have the repatriation of some people willing to fight at home, became a real problem for the neighboring countries of zones of conflict first. And then when their own country kind of turned against them or allied themselves with the West, may have become, or actually did become, a real problem for their own country. And here I'm talking about Saudi Arabia, where a lot of people who had been in Afghanistan came back, was Al-Qaeda in Saudi Arabia, and for about 2.5 years had a real fight with the Ministry of the Interior until the Ministry of the Interior finally got the upper hand around January 2006. But between May 2003 and January 2006, it was really kind of an iffy fight. It was also extremely significant for Algeria. A lot of foreign fighters coming back from Afghanistan and also Egypt, but that became more significant when Al-Qaeda moved to the Sudan. And therefore, they were next door to Egypt, you know, and you can see they were sending people. They now have become significant for Turkey. and now also Germany, and I'll talk about it. All right, so out of the 70 plots, do we have this wandering Mujahideen phenomenon? Of the 70 plots, more than a third, about 25, are foreign-trained people. So at least one member of the conspiracy was trained abroad. And those are probably the most serious plot, you know, the plot that come to mind very quickly. But in terms of people who fought in those wars, only seven. Only seven. Those were the First World Trade Center, the New York landmark plot of 1993, the Roubaix gang, who came from Bosnia, in a sense, in 96, a little plot against the G7 meeting, 9/11, of course, attacks, the German Al-Tawhid plot of 2002, the French Chechen network, the Ricin plot of December 2002, and now, after a jump of about 7 years, probably the Neath plot in Australia, and that's kind of coming out of Somalia. Now, this is, in a sense, very, very surprising, because you're absolutely right. In terms of foreign fighters to foreign train, the foreign fighters completely swamped the foreign trained guys. So what's going on here? People, and that's why I think it's very important to disaggregate the foreign fighter from the foreign train, and they are not the same. So far, we have not seen any bleed out from Iraq, despite 7 years of conflict in the West, none. You know, they can say that perhaps the Glasgow plot, no, that really wasn't. I completely, you're right. Lorenzo is kind of my echo. You know, this is kind of very interesting. It seems that the foreign fighters, despite the identity, despite the capability, don't really come back and do terrorism in the West. There are some interesting cases. I agree with you on trends, but you know the trends generate out of the numbers. The French case, the wave of bombing, out of the 70 plots that I have, 11 of them were the wave of bombings in France and assassination in the summer of 1995. This was a GIA raid to France. Three of the core, the active core, were three guys who came from Algiers to Paris and kind of started bombing with the support of another Algerian in London. They did try to recruit some local French people. And, you know, I love the French because they arrest everybody. And so it's nice if you actually look at people who might have been involved in the plot, you kind of look at all the 72 guys that have been arrested. Of the 72 guys, only about 10 had direct involvement in the plot. What is interesting is that all the people who had gone to Afghanistan, and of the 72, there were 9, and another 9 who had gone to Bosnia, and there were overlap, none of them were part of the plot. Indeed, when they were asked, three of them, namely Joseph Zem, a guy named David Valla, and Besbas, their best friend, who were hosting the leader of the plot, Ali Touchant, in their apartment in the suburb of Lyon, was asked by Ali Touchant, now it's time to go to the next level and to bomb in France. They threw him out of the apartment. And the guy was absolutely homeless and had to turn to a hoodlum named Khaled Kelkal, who became very famous because he agreed to actually be part of the plot. So this is actually a fascinating case. People who actually become foreign fighters may actually think of themselves as real soldiers and not terrorists. Interesting. The Kravis case. Kravis case, if I remind you, was, 7 people eight people, because one Canadian. Six of them were convicted of trying to bomb an unknown target in London in 2004. They were arrested on March 30th, 2004. This is called the Kravis case. This is a fertilizer bomb case, half a ton of fertilizer that was done. Now, those guys had, first of all, gone to Pakistan in order to be foreign fighters. But the Al-Qaeda guys did not trust them. And so told them that now they didn't need them, and Afghanistan was close to foreigners. And so in their disappointment, they decided to do something in England. And they were all excited, you know, they kind of got 2 days of training twice. Very poor training, I must say, because and we know a lot about it because half of them talked. So, and you have to read the trial transcripts for that. And they decided to do something in England. They came back, they were enthusiastic, they bought a half ton of fertilizer, and then nothing. The fertilizer was bought on November 10, 2004, and they didn't do anything. They kind of put in storage. They actually, one guy, Omar Khayyam, came to visit the storage only 4.5 months later, at the end of March. And they didn't really do anything. They didn't buy any other stuff. They didn't do anything for that. But in December, they learned that Afghanistan was open for foreigners, and they instead were buying equipment and clothes and so on in order to go to Afghanistan and fight, not so much to do terrorism. Another fairly interesting case that shows you that perhaps there may be a difference between the two, and you shouldn't really kind of confuse the two. Somalia, you know, we have at least 40 people by FBI count who have gone, Americans who have gone to Somalia. None have come back to really kind of try to do anything here in this country. They're happy to kill Americans in Somalia, as other people would be happy to kill Americans or Western forces abroad. So, you know, despite all of this, kind of, in a sense, recentering view of things, there are some negative aspects that are coming for in terms of trend. And the latest trends are really about the Turks and the Germans. After the creation of IJU, the Islamic Jihad Union, which is an Uzbek splinter of the IMU, which is the Islamic movement of Uzbekistan, if I recall, there is now a lot of talk about those guys coming back to Germany and coming back to Turkey. They are actually the most numerous people now, I think, in Pakistan of Western or neo-Western forces. If you look at, you know, I kind of try to look at the census of people in prison in Pakistan. That's kind of my my view of it. And the Turks and the Germans outnumber just about everything else. This is very worrisome. This is very worrisome. And I think that now you know probably that in Europe they are on a very high state of alert for various reasons, but this is one of them. Both in Germany, especially in France, where they just had a witch hunt about a woman who was going to blow herself in a train last week, and they also evacuated the Eiffel Tower last Wednesday. I mean, so you can see, but this also has to do with something else going on in Africa, namely the kidnapping of the five French engineers in Mauritania. But anyway, there may be a bleed-out problem now from Afghanistan to France and Belgium and Germany and perhaps England. But you know, let's kind of see. Now, in terms of the threat level, I'm trying to answer some of the questions that you put. So in terms of the wandering Mujahideen, I completely disagree with that. The numbers, the data does not support that. She's wrong. It's just that simple. I just kind of gave you all the data on this. War team capability, yes, but Not for the trained Mujahideen. Now training is really very short. It's about 2 days in Pidgin English or Pidgin Urdu that the actual people coming back to the West often don't understand the language, which is why they keep emailing back their trainers, say, is this right? And of course, that's how we catch them. So that tells you a little bit about the poverty of the training. This is not the 1990s, where you could take courses of 2 months in bomb building. This is just 2 days training in a rented house, and often you kind of move in the middle of your training. So that's, you know, and this is very much from the debrief that were presented at court for the Bayayo trial in Belgium. Identification. I think they identify more as soldiers as opposed to as terrorists. So identification can cut both ways. You know, I'm just kind of raising question. I'm really kind of urging you not to confuse, you know, a lot of things. I think that probably the foreign fighter phenomenon may be a problem for the neighbors. They are a problem for some Middle Eastern countries like Saudi Arabia, although less so now, but definitely a problem for Yemen. In Africa, it's so confusing. I'm not really sure what's happening, you know, because it's really very confusing, and has also a lot to do with our presence and the French presence over there as well. So the threat level, I would say it's moderate. The internet is really playing a huge role, and the role is that it glorifies people who are foreign fighters, and that often draws people to those areas. And sometimes those guys are turned around without becoming foreign fighters when people that they contact say, we have much better ideas for you, forget about fighting here. Why don't we send you at home? That's really the big danger. They're not really foreign fighters. They've just been kind of cornered off at the pass. I think that the notion of franchise is a wrong one. It's a wrong metaphor. It implies that, you know, there is some central organization that kind of sets up franchises. Now, what we see is really a bottom-up phenomenon. You know, like our five guys from Northern Virginia here who actually go to Pakistan in order to become foreign fighters and really don't succeed simply because terrorist organizations don't trust them. This is often what we see. In terms of did the internet supplant training areas? Not really. What really kind of destroyed the training areas is really good kinetic activity by the military. We destroyed the camps. Each time we see a camp, we're going to kind of bomb it. That's not, you know, the internet is just, nobody really trusts this. You heard about the Inspire magazine. The interesting thing about Inspire is how uninspiring it is. It is commented greatly on Arabic chat room, not English chat room, even though the target of Inspire was an English audience. We just don't see much diffusion on English chat room, and indeed it's so popular on Arabic chat room, people who cannot read that magazine Inspire, that was just translated last week into Arabic and diffused on the Al-Sumukh chat room, and also led to the demise of the Al-Fallujah chat room, which was the main conduit of all the previous Al-Qaeda propaganda. So what I'm just raising is a lot of question, trying to have a little bit more of analytical clarity in this issue. And I'll stop here. Thanks.
Thanks, Marc. Lorenzo?
Okay, thank you. First of all, I just wanted to clarify one thing about my affiliation. I'm not technically at the RAND Corporation. I'm just a visiting fellow there starting next week. So nothing of what I'm going to be saying has anything to do with RAND. I'd really like to thank Michael for the invitation, which came in at sort of a last minute, but gave me a very good opportunity to ask some of his former jihadists that was interviewing in Italy some 10 days ago about their experience as foreign fighters. This is a very small cluster of Tunisian immigrants that came to Italy in the mid-90s, radicalized, and then went to Afghanistan to train, came back, some of them came back, and were subsequently arrested. Now, quite a few of them have either disengaged or de-radicalized and are working with Italian authorities, with Italian magistrates. Interest in them was mostly on the de-radicalization process, but as Michael gave me the idea, I also asked him about their experience as foreign fighters. And what struck me from what the three that I interviewed told me was how random the whole experience, their experience as foreign fighters was. And I thought about it. It seems to be more than just in these three cases, but in general, the whole experience of foreign fighters is often shaped by coincidences and events that are largely beyond the control of the wannabe foreign fighter. Now, take this example. All these three men ended up in Afghanistan because the place where they were actually recruited or met with somebody who opened sort of the gates of Afghanistan to them had a pipeline going to Afghanistan, that is the Islamic Cultural Institute in Milan, the ICI in Milan. We're talking about 98. Had it been 93, they would have gone to Bosnia. Had it been 2003, they would have gone to Iraq. They happened to be sent to Afghanistan, but they all told me they had no knowledge whatsoever of Afghanistan, the language and what was taking place in Afghanistan at the time once they left. Once in Afghanistan, their paths divided again for reasons that are well beyond their control, not of their own decision. One of them had the military training in the Tunisian army and was sent north to fight against the Northern Alliance. Now, what interesting, what this individual told me is that he had no knowledge whatsoever of the conflict and didn't even understand until reaching actually the conflict area that the Northern Alliance were actually fellow Muslims. Had no idea. Second individual had no military training and was sent to the camps. And the third individual had also no military training, but had some university education, and so was sent to a camp for receive specific training in explosives. So again, reasons beyond their control. And once back from Afghanistan, again, their decisions matter little to what happens to them. The one that went fighting against the Northern Alliance is sent to Algeria to continue fighting there. The other two go back to Europe to carry out attacks, which they never did. All this is to say, really, that it's something that we've seen in many other cases, that their decision matters little. The Hamburg cell is a wonderful example of that. The 9/11 Commission report tells us the story of this, what is soon to be the famous Hamburg cell, which is at the time just a few radicalized individuals who are watching a lot of tapes from Chechnya and want to go to Chechnya. They happen to meet on a train an Al-Qaeda recruiter, a Mauritanian, that tells them, don't go to Chechnya, it's difficult to get there. Go to Afghanistan. I'll make some connections. I have some connections. I'll open the doors for you. And they end up going to Afghanistan. And then, you know, we're talking about Mohammed Atta and the people who carried out 9/11. But I would argue that for a lot of these wannabe foreign fighters or wannabe jihadists, this sort of randomness is perfectly fine. They want to fight jihad. It matters little where they go, what destination they go to. This, of course, with two exceptions. The first one would be people with ethnic links to a certain jihad destination. So Somalis or Pakistanis in Europe or in North America are unlikely to travel to countries other than Somalia or Pakistan. And then we have another exception, would be people with no ethnic links, but somehow particularly connected to a certain country, to a certain destination. Now, that could be for political reasons. I think back in 2003, 2004, we had people that went from the West, from Europe to Iraq, with the specific idea of going just to Iraq, because the conflict was so heartfelt by some that they wouldn't want to go to any place. They wanted to go to Iraq. And then we have people with personal reasons. I think today on the panel with about Somalia, I think we're probably going to be talking about Hamami, you know, the Alabama-born Shabab member, who had some personal connection to Somalia because he married a Somali woman, was sort of hanging out in the Somali community in Toronto and had a fascination with Somalia. So these are sort of the exceptions. Now, let me make some general comments. We're going to be talking about four different destinations, and from a European perspective, there are some differences among these four theaters. When it comes to the Maghreb, Northern Africa, I think that is sort of an exception. It's different compared to the other three in that only ethnic North Africans happen to travel to the Maghreb and join AQIM there. There's fewer people that go from Europe, and I would argue they are, for the most part, if not all, ethnically North Africans. Somalia is also a peculiar reason compared to the other three. That is arguably the only place where I can see there's active recruitment taking place. We agree again today on the fact that the whole issue of recruitment, I think, is largely misunderstood or misapplied to the European arena. There's little recruitment actually taking place, as you have written in the past. It's more like selection in, for an Ivy League school. So there's not the recruiter going around and spotting people. It's more people who want to be part of a jihadi network. But I think Somalia is a bit of an exception. And we've seen quite extensive, active, and 2 or 3 years ago, quite open recruitment, even in mosques, taking place for Somalia. Back when Ethiopia invaded Somalia, there was a tour done by Islamic Courts Union and Shabab leaders to Europe, coming to 4 or 5 countries, going to Somali mosques, and actually some known Somali mosques, and literally recruiting people to go to Somalia. They really reminded me of this sort of tour, the way it was described to me by different people, as the tours that Abdullah Azzam or other people did in the 80s to call people to Afghanistan. So quite open, maybe because authorities weren't paying that much attention to Somalia back a couple of years ago. That is not to say, anyways, that Somalia is immune from another recent trend, which is people going to a certain destination, jihad destination, with no ties whatsoever. Just hopping on a plane, flying to Nairobi, flying to Syria when it was for Iraq, or flying to Pakistan, and just hoping in a way to make their way to a camp or to the front line, but with no ties whatsoever. This is something that it wasn't that common a few years ago. The internet might have helped, but it wasn't that common. I think it's a trend we're starting to see more and more. It doesn't really happen in the Maghreb, but it happens in the other three places. Now, of course, some of these people that go without ties have been rejected. Some of them actually reportedly killed as spies or suspected to be spies. But quite a few of them, of course, have been accepted. And I think it's staggering easy how to notice how it's staggering to see how easy it was for some people with no connections whatsoever to be accepted and actually rise up in the ranks of some of these Al-Qaeda affiliated formations in these four different theaters. Some of them even white converts, arguably more suspicious in a way in the eyes of these organizations. If we try to look at the glass half full in this way, this creates sort of an opportunity for intelligence agencies who want to penetrate these organizations. We've been talking about Europe a lot. I think it's somehow deceiving to always talk about Europe because there are huge differences between one country and the other in terms of patterns and in terms of destinations of where wannabe foreign fighters go. In Spain, the pipeline really goes to mostly North Africa, used to be Iraq. If we're talking about Sweden, it's largely Somalia. Germany, as we heard, is really Pakistan
within Pakistan.
Yeah, and we actually have these villages of Germans, a lot of them of Turkish background, but probably 50-50 between Turks and converts, German converts, who are living there, but some of them, of course, are coming back. Some other countries like the UK or Denmark or France see few people. We're talking about really few individuals that go to different destinations. What is different from the past is that all European countries see the phenomenon as dangerous. It wasn't exactly like that in the 90s, at least not in all countries. Now there's an understanding of the potential backlash of this phenomenon. Some of the legal challenges that existed in most European countries in the 90s have been removed. In most countries, it wasn't a crime to go and join, go and receive training, go and join a group fighting over abroad. So all these sort of different phenomenon were not criminally relevant. Now, this has changed in most countries, but I think there are still huge issues. We go back to what we've been talking about in terms of definition, in terms of what it means to be a foreign fighter, whether it means receiving training, whether it means actually fighting in the front lines. Some legislations in some countries have been trying to clarify that, but I think in many countries we still have problems. My native Italy, just to give you an example, we have had cases of individuals who went to train with Al-Qaeda, with Ansar al-Islam in northern Iraq, and were convicted, found guilty of supporting terrorism. While we had other people who actually joined Al-Qaeda in Iraq, fought, yet were not found guilty of anything, because technically they were not considered to be training, but the fighting was not covered. Of course, there's some political issues that go with the idea that some judges might have thought of them as freedom fighters. But the lack of clarity here is a big problem in Europe. Aside from the legal issues that come with the differentiating between those that go abroad to receive training and those that go abroad to fight, I think, and I really have to, I have to take out a pretty big chunk of my speech in terms of the difference in threat, because I have to agree again with what has been said about the almost paradoxical lack of threat coming from those that go abroad to fight. If it's unquestionable that those that have gone abroad and received training and have come back are those behind the most serious plots against the West over the last 10 years, I had struggled a bit to find plots, and Marc was much better than I was in finding seven, plots in which people who actually went to the front line came back to Europe and were behind attacks. It's really an interesting case of why there are so few. You said seven. It really ties into the impact of foreign fighters. We're sort of asked to assess the impact of foreign fighters, and it's if I don't doubt that it's huge in places like Somalia or Iraq, a few years ago at least, it is not that big in Europe, I would say, at this point. Everybody was expecting sort of a massive influx and a consequent onslaught of attacks from returnees of Iraq. That really didn't take place. It is unquestionable that those who come back with foreign fighting experience, we're talking about just simply fighting, not training, possess an expertise and an aura that makes them stand out in the jihadi communities of Europe. But we're not in a phase of massive influence. We're not on high alert just because of this. I think it's been a sort of a steady phenomenon over the last 15, 20 years of seeing people going to fight around the world and coming back to Europe. So I don't see that as a huge phenomenon right now compared to the past. Almost to conclude, we're also asked to see what we see for the future. I still see the four areas we're going to be talking about as relevant. If I might just speculate on what could be a fifth geographical area where we could see this sort of foreign fighting / training in the future, would be sub-Saharan Africa, some parts of Nigeria, some parts of the neighboring countries. We've seen it's very much in its infancy now, and it doesn't mean that it's going to develop that way, but we've seen a very small number of Europeans who have gone to these places, linked up with local militants. So this could be potentially an area to be sort of on the lookout. I don't know what I'm doing with time. I might have an extra point, Michael.
Okay, you can make it.
You might. Okay, which is sort of a pet peeve of mine, which is a comparison between the European experience and the US. I think for a long time has been sort of a common understanding that the foreign fighting phenomenon was a European issue, and it really didn't affect Muslims in the United States. I think this assumption goes hand in hand with the belief, which has been only recently challenged, that American Muslims are virtually immune to radicalization because they're well integrated into society, while European Muslims are not well integrated and hence more prone to radicalization. I personally challenge these assumptions for quite a bit because I think they're not really supported by the facts. And when it comes, for example, to the foreign fighting for Americans being foreign fighters, I think we've seen evidence dating back to the 80s of Americans going abroad to fight. back during the Cold War against the Soviets. We've seen, of course, it's a little more of an anecdotal evidence, but many cases of American Muslims, whether immigrants of Muslim background, or quite a few, for example, of from the Black Muslim community who went to Afghanistan to fight. We've also saw a movement which wasn't really considered a threat back in the 90s of people from the States going to whether it was Afghanistan or other places to receive training. Robert Blitzer, who headed the FBI's first task force on Islamism, stated that in the 90s he estimates that between 1,000 and 2,000 people left the United States to fight or receive training in Afghanistan, Pakistan. That's a pretty significant number. Of course, it needs to be double checked, but I would argue that with the exception of the UK, no other country would in Europe would see such a big number. Of course, it really needs to be double checked. I think I can close it here. Otherwise, okay. I have too big of a parenthesis to open.
Okay. Thanks, Lorenzo. Clint?
All right. I get to bad that cleanup, I guess. I don't know if I'm on or not. I won't narrow down just on Western plots. I have some disagreement a little bit with what's been said because I look at it more from the global perspective. But, Mike, should I switch this?
All right. You didn't miss anything important. So, what I was saying was I'm going to focus not on Western plots as much. I'm going to talk about the phenomenon more from a global perspective. And I want to talk about five things in general. One, the process stays the same. The places change. Two, the results of the fighters versus martyrs decision that each recruit has to make, which is key in the process and tells you a lot about what I think will happen in the future. The third is physical versus virtual recruitment, which is a hot button issue that a lot of people like to talk about, and I'll bring up, probably won't make anyone happy, but I'll talk about it anyways. And specifically that, in that I'll talk about what I call long tail losers. I'm not talking about guys with mullets and Camaros. I'm talking about internet phenomenon that kind of arise that really can help us sort of model out this analytically. The fourth thing is what we can learn from ants. And the fifth thing is what we can do, which I think is make villains, not martyrs, which is sort of a strategic approach to dealing with foreign fighters. So first, the process stays the same. Most of the foreign fighter recruits come from maybe two dozen towns around the globe. And I'm talking about gross total. I'm not just talking about Western plots. There's probably two dozen towns where most foreign fighter recruits come from, probably 80% of them. From those, you know, flashpoint cities, they transit to safe haven sanctuary networks like's already been talked about, and they receive training, indoctrination, a lot of times get equipped, and then they get, you know, facilitated to targets. Lorenzo gave a great description of how that sort of happens. The recruits don't necessarily know where they're going, but they get in the pipeline and they get tracked onto a certain target. And then eventually they arrive at their target. The most, I think, telling recruitment model to explain that is actually a U.S. military recruitment model, an all-volunteer, multi-ethnic force that fights overseas for a common ideology. You're a recruiter. We got a lot of military folks out here. You're a recruiter. You get assigned to recruit at least two recruits every month. You get to choose where you want to live, and you don't really care, you know, about lifestyle or anything. You just want to get your two recruits. You can go recruit in Texas, or you can go recruit in Vermont. Military folks, where are you going to go recruit?
Texas,
right? Okay, foreign fighters know that too. Veterans know that. You go where the crops are at. You don't try and plant, you know, where there's no water. That process is very, very much indicative of how foreign fighters are recruited. The best recruiter of a Marine is a former Marine, right? They love saying that. The best recruiter of a foreign fighter is a former foreign fighter. That brings me to my next thing. In the recruitment process, especially in the Sinjar records, the most telling piece of data that's in there is they let the actual recruits make a decision. They could choose to be fighters or martyrs. And there's lots of air with that, and there's probably a lot of groupthink going on. But one thing that's very illustrative of where they're coming from and how they're thinking is that those that chose to be fighters versus those that chose to be martyrs. Certain countries, certain cities had way more fighters than they had martyrs. Algeria, Yemen, Tunisia, 1, 2, and 3 chose to be fighters. Morocco, Libya, Saudi Arabia chose to be martyrs. In 2008, terrorist attacks outside of Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, number one and two, Algeria, Yemen. Those people flow back to where they came from. And if, you know, they're not sort of dealt with, then what are they going to do? You know, some of them retire. Some of them go back to a normal life. Some of them float around to a new sanctuary. But ultimately, some of them are going to come back around. When they say they want to be a fighter, they're saying, ah, you know, if I die in the process, you know, that's tough. But if I don't, I do intend to go back. And when I go back, I'm going to take skills with me. I'll come back to the Iraq bleed out thing in a second because I differ. I don't really look at it from just a strictly Western sort of plots perspective. The next thing is physical versus virtual recruitment. Both happen. Physical recruitment is way more powerful. We know that from our own experience in the U.S. military. If you want to recruit people, you can do, you know, internet ads. I watched Rambo when I was a kid. It's all fantastic. I get excited. You know, I joined the military. But where did it really come from? It came from social and family connections. I'm in my neighborhood. There's former foreign fighters all around me. They're not necessarily organized Al-Qaeda recruiters, but they're people that know how to make way for you to get to the next conflict. They know how to get you excited. You want to be like them and emulate them, and they know facilitation networks. I think the Minneapolis case here in the West, just to throw a Western example in here, is very illustrative. They had a facilitator there, Mahmoud Saeed Omar, who I think was ultimately picked up by the Danes. He facilitated that. And what was the recruitment like in that node? It was exponential. He sort of helped them get along their route. Then there's the virtual side of it. Virtual internet, I know it's the boogeyman. I know we like it. We spend a lot of time on the internet every day, and it does assist and help in facilitating recruitment. But it's very, very hard to establish that trusting relationship. The five guys from Alexandria, they tried to join three different groups. Why? Why did they have so much trouble? They didn't have that physical connection there to actually guide them through. There is a great descriptions about there about how each group met with these guys when they got over there, and they gave a donation of $6. I'm sure those groups were thrilled to get $6 more, you know, to their thing. Then they migrated to another group, and they tried to join another group, and they got denied. A key thing in this, and I'm not discounting that the internet can recruit people, but is trust. In physical relationships, there are trust. In virtual ones, there are not. If you've ever traveled to go meet somebody that you met over the internet, and you get there and it doesn't feel quite right, like you're having dinner and it isn't really the greatest relationship, it was great on the internet, you know, it wasn't now. You show up to someone's house, you know, when you travel overseas, you take the leap, you get over there, the guy's not a lot of fun to be around, he's kind of crazy, I had a different interpretation in my mind. Yes, they can be recruited. And that's what I talk about, long tail losers. We talk about the internet, the whole phenomenon of the long tail, which is essentially, you know, yes, I make seven-fingered left-handed baseball gloves, and I could never sell them as a business, you know, if I had a shop in Tennessee. But if I put it out on the internet, eventually over time, I'll probably sell 30 or 40 left-handed, you know, seven-finger baseball gloves because I can reach a huge audience. And I can market, you know, for as long as I want. It doesn't really cost me anything. These terrorist groups are doing the same thing. These guys, Gadon, I think it's Chester or whoever the latest guy I saw was yelling out in front of the White House. They got some great footage of that.
Chester.
You know, these guys are just as likely to drift into something else. You know, they're going to get recruited. It's going to happen. But they're also some of the lower hanging fruit. Good terrorists, and I mean this from like a performance standpoint, aren't just floating around on the internet. The ones that we like to talk about a lot of times, constantly picking up, oh, this guy's in a chat room, this guy's in that. Yeah, they're terrorist recruits. We need to deal with them. And we're getting a lot better at picking them off and assessing them. But I'm more worried about the ones we're not seeing floating around on the internet. I'm worried about the ones that are meeting people locally in the coffee shops overseas or in the mosque in Algeria in a specific town that's produced foreign fighter recruits since the 1970s. That's who I'm really worried about. So I'm not discounting the virtual part of it, but we spend a lot of time here on the internet because we can and we have a lot of internet. I'm more worried about the physical recruitment that's going on and how that regenerates itself. Next, learning from ants. Part of this model and what I wanted to talk about is ant colony optimization. I know this sounds crazy. Maybe this will be the last time I talk about it. Who knows? But ants. there's a lot of research going on in natural sciences about how ant colonies organize. We struggled after 9/11 to model how these recruiting patterns turned out, because we're used to our hierarchical models. You know, we send out a recruiting depot, we send people out, they market, you know, they bring in new recruits, we build them into the organization. So I think foreign fighters more model how ants colonize, form to find food sources. And there's some great science that's out there about how they find food sources. When ants, if you ever watch ants on the ground, you know, when they go to find food, they're kind of going all over the place, and then the one ant finds it, and then you watch them, and then all the ants are going to where that food is from. Well, they actually release what's called pheromones, which help all the other ants track down on that path to the food source. It's actual physical reaction. Foreign fighters do the same thing. You'll get a group of five or six of them together. They all are radicalizing each other. They're getting kind of excited and round up. They all start seeking out ways, you know, to try and get into these foreign fighter networks. Sometimes they're successful. Sometimes they run into an undercover FBI or law enforcement guy, right? And we pick those guys off. But sometimes they actually make it all the way through. The Minneapolis case is great. And what happens when they make it through and it goes well? They start sending back signals, phone calls, emails, Facebook. That's where that sort of internet, I think, capability can be very helpful. And there are models out there, I believe, right now that we can be using to detect when those cells and those organizations are actually coming together. Computer science folks use this ant stuff like crazy, and they're the ones to do it. But I think that's a very good model for examining how these sort of decentralized groups radicalize or aren't formally recruited, but they get themselves together and get themselves into a pipeline that gets them to the actual battlefields that they're traveling to. Last, what do we do? My big message, I think, is to learn from ourselves. We've got the greatest, largest, multi-ethnic, all-volunteer force on the planet. And from that, we focus on recruitment in those flashpoint cities and flashpoint locations. We know where they're being recruited from. If I was in Afghanistan right now, I would start looking at the foreign fighters that come through. I'd start figuring out which ones choose to be fighters versus martyrs. I'd focus on the fighters, and I would find out where their hometowns are, and that's where I would go next. I would start looking there, and that's where I'd focus my IO, you know, public affairs, development sort of skills and training at. The next thing is focus on actually making that former foreign fighter a villain rather than a martyr. And by this, I'll give you an example. What was the most devastating recruitment example to the U.S. military ever? Probably Lieutenant Calley, right? We hated Lieutenant Calley when he came back. What did he do? He committed atrocities, and he wasn't sorry for it. Guess what former foreign fighters are good at doing? Committing atrocities and not feeling bad about it. We've pursued campaigns, let's say in Saudi Arabia or Algeria, all in North Africa, where we go and we try and market the entire Muslim world to convince them that, you know, we're actually standing up for democracy, which we are. But we really only need to focus on about two dozen key nodes. And we need to make sure that those former people that are going back, those former foreign fighters that are going to be the recruiting nexus for the next round, everybody understands the atrocities they're committing overseas. I doubt that message is actually getting into that local information environment. And number two, the other strategy is what I call false prophets. I see this all the time. I'm from Missouri, so I see this, you know, occasionally. Everybody goes back and they have, you know, their war stories about, you know, how things are and what they're doing. But half the time, those turn out not to be true. A lot of these former foreign fighters, guess what? If they made it back to their hometown, how did they do on the battlefield? They didn't do so good, right? They didn't do exactly what they said they do. So that's a second sort of messaging strategy that can be used. Lastly, I think there are tons of indirect approaches that can be used. I don't have enough empirical evidence of it, but if I had to pick one thing tomorrow that I would start funding, it'd be marriage programs in recruitment cities in North Africa and the Middle East. There's a great story in the New York Times about how a lot of these guys who are potential recruits, 18 to 26 years old, you know, they also were looking at getting married. They couldn't afford it, this and things. I just know from personal experience and, you know, being almost 40 years old now, once you got a wife and kids, your perspective changes dramatically, and you stop thinking like a 18 to 26-year-old. Sure, there are recruits, you know, with families that go over and blow themselves up. But right now I'm trying to look at the actual analysis, to look at the sort of psychological, social dimensions and how that can be changed with these sort of indirect approaches, which are actually very cost-effective. The last thing I wanted to note was more just in terms of discussion, Mike. So I'll close there. I had a couple of questions in terms of the model Dr. Sageman brought up. Okay. Thanks.
Before we open it up to some cross-panel discussion, did anybody want to make any – did anyone want to comment on anything Anything anybody else said on the panel?
Well, I guess I have a brief response.
Okay.
I don't want to drag Ms. Bennett's name into this little disagreement we're having. So let's just say my response to your comments about the prediction being incorrect actually plays right into my point about the dangers of being too terrorism-centric when we judge the effects of foreign fighters. Because you made a very persuasive case that there aren't very many foreign fighters involved in terrorist plots, and therefore the bleed-out problem isn't as big as many think it is. But if we measure the effects of wars in terms of capabilities generated, and not just number of plots and plotters, the story might look a little different. And so what I'm trying to do is push our way of thinking beyond just counting plots and plotters, because that's the only way we can anticipate things in the future rather than react to something that's already happened. So.
I had a question, Dr. Sageman, in terms of your model. There are two cases that came to mind. These are Western cases. You had mentioned, I didn't know if you had mentioned the Christmas attempt of this past year, 2009?
No.
Okay. I guess in terms of your model, what I was trying to figure out was two of the key leaders in Al-Qaeda in Yemen are Saudis who had fought in Iraq, were detained in Gitmo, were released, went to Yemen, helped conduct an attack on the U.S. Embassy in Yemen, I think, if I'm correct, I know there's Yemen folks out here, and then, were instrumental in getting the plot together for Abdul Muttalib to attack in the U.S. So I wasn't sure if that fits into your model, because that's an attack on the West by bleed out from Iraq. I mean, those two were instrumental in putting that plot together. And then at the same point, I wanted to ask about the Portland 7, which is a case I'm very familiar with. Habas Abdullah Al-Sub was a Palestinian who fought in Afghanistan, came to the U.S., but is that not considered a Western plot because they traveled to China to try and join the Taliban?
There was no act in furtherance.
I'm sorry?
There was no act in furtherance. They didn't buy any explosive and so on in order to count. Otherwise, you have thousands of plots where people just talk around a campfire about, wouldn't it be nice to blow up the Long Island Railroad? That was it. That was the extent of that plot, the Venus plot, no matter what CNN tells you. There was right. Nothing else.
But what about the Yemen example? I mean, that's the Yemen example, Iraq bleed out
A fair example. I'm looking at Omar Farouk Abdulmatullah. He never fought anywhere. He was trained. The training's kind of minimal, but that's not really what kind of so much attracted him there. What attracted him is Anwar Al-Awlaki, who, again, was not part of the bleed out, but, has evolved into the greater threat, I think, that we have now against the United States. So, I see where you're going, namely that, if some of the trainers may have had some kind of fighting capability, would you consider those? You may have a point there, but it's not going to count as a Western plot in the West. The only thing West out there is the airplane that was landing in Detroit. And, none of the guys, Abdulmatullah was not a foreign fighter. This may be one of your concept, namely that there is some kind of nexus there. But that's not what we see in the West. Even anybody is trained, that's less still than a third of all the cases in the West. What we see in the West is homegrown terrorism. They're all, in a sense, homegrown. They kind of radicalize here, and there is no recruiter here. I'm sorry. There's not a single recruiter that the Bureau has arrested, anybody in Europe has arrested. There's not a single recruiter. There is no Al-Qaeda sending staff to Europe. It's all volunteers going out there.
I understand that, but my question is the utility of your model, though, if it only has to be people that actually commit acts in the West. I mean, there's a border you're putting there on that framework where you're saying you know, it has to be a recruiter in this specific location. My other point is, you say, like, the Portland 7 plot is not being a serious or viable plot, but are you also counting plots like the Fort Dix guys and the fellas at the JFK airport?
That's an entrapment case.
I'm just asking. I mean, are those
no?
You
have
okay.
Well? The way
that creates, you know, other right. instances, other counts.
That's right. I mean, or the Yonkers plot right now, which right. is, you know, this stinks at best. I'm not involved in either side of the legal case. In many other cases, I am. But some cases I just refuse because, you know, they just, you know, there's nothing there. Now, you have to draw a line, and the line is accent furtherance. There are a lot of upset young Muslim who want to do something. That's part of youth, actually.
Right.
There are thousands almost, I would say, throughout Europe and the United States. Now, you know, when I deal, and you know, I'm always operationally minded, which is why I don't write that much, because, you know, right now I'm kind of working for the G2 of the Army before the NYPD, so I'm kind of looking. People ask me, you know, there are a lot of young people who make a lot of noise and a very vicious, nasty thing on the internet. I'm a terrorist and so on, and I'm going to blow this guy up. But they don't do anything. They don't do anything. Maybe out of 100 who kind of make those noise, maybe one becomes acts out. And so people ask me, say, how can I tell the guy who acts out from the guys who boast and brag and pretend just because they want to impress the girls? In a sense, I don't agree with you on the marriage. You know, I've kind of demonstrated, and I think everybody else has agreed with me, that most of the terrorists are married. No, it's who you marry. And so the model that I have is not really what I've kind of further. The model that I have, in it's mostly the West, I agree, because you can't really get very good information outside the West. It's all fairly tainted. It's the notion that the turn to violence emerged out of a context, and this context is a protest counterculture. And the key here is really to kind of see what is the transition phase from the protest counterculture, which in liberal democracy usually is still legal, which is part of our problem in trying to fight this huge problem of terrorism, and, you know, who actually turns to violence from this kind of protest counterculture. So, you know, I'm looking at a lot of indicators from there, and that's a model in the West.
Well, you brought up a lot about the internet and Alaki right. and Yemen and those sorts of things, and you mentioned Mutallab. And I guess what I'm trying
Abdul
to stress.
Mutallab. That's Abdul his last Mutallab. Name. That's yes. his last name.
Okay.
Omar Farouk is.
So you brought him up,
yeah,
and you said he was recruited by Alaki, but he went to school in London.
Yeah.
And he got to Yemen.
Yes.
This was all done through the internet, or did he also meet people in London and, you know,
this was all done on the internet. I can't really go into that. There was a very, very good study done at a very high level of classification looking at everything we captured from him, and it was all done via the internet, unfortunately, which is what makes it scary. You know, because that really, as you point out, would enlarge the pool. Now, let me go back to marriage.
Can I finish with one more question?
Okay.
Do we believe that that all happened through the internet because that's how we went about researching it? Or has anybody examined the actual physical sort of context? I only bring this up because Lorenzo just got done talking about all of these guys he interviewed. You know, they start on the pipeline. They listen to all sorts of media. Mm-hmm. They listen to video and everything. But then they encounter other people on the train or other people that have been there, and they say, hey, you know what? You shouldn't go that way. You should go this way. I just bring this up because there's all sorts of internet, too, about how you get recruited for jobs, and you put on monster.com, right. and you make it through. And how many people ever have been hired through that? A few. But, I mean, percentage-wise, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but how do we mostly come about our relationships bring us to those sorts of contacts? We end up in places because of relationships. I only bring this up, and I'm not trying to, people think that I'm like just anti-internet. I use the internet every day. I use it for my research. It's great. It's going to change the world. It already has. I've said it. Okay. But my issue is we have become so centric to the internet that we're overlooking the fact that the strongest plots, the strongest recruitment networks, they occur in physical relationships still to this day. And I guess that's my closing point. I'm not going to argue back and forth about it forever. We just have different points of view on it. But I just wanted to bring that up because it keeps coming up in each one of these, and it comes up a lot in Western analysis. So I just wondered, you know, if we look back to 1979 and 80, would we be making a fuss about Al-Qaeda's use of 8-track cassette tapes and, you know, that sort of media, which was extremely powerful. If you read Larry Wright, they were handing out that sort of media. I'm not saying it's not. But I worry that from an analytical perspective, the way we're going about foreign fighter networks and terrorism and how it relates to these insurgencies around the globe, we're not focusing enough on the physical relationships that are there. That's all. I'll shut up.
Well, the physical relationship was there before 9/11. 9/11, what 9/11 did is that all Western law enforcement agencies cleaned up. And so it kind of eliminated them. But as you can see, it doesn't eliminate the threat to the West. And that very much, especially since really 2005, 2006, the internet started coming in very big, not really before then. And that's because people change their ideas through, every idea is really mediated through group discussions. And it used to be those intimate discussions face-to-face, but now they take place on chat rooms. And that's really where the internet comes in. It's not really those images and so on that people, you know, the website. It's really very much interactivity that makes people change their mind and adapt some very extremist views. Now, let's go back to the marriage, because I always make the point that you can't fight the jihad and your wife at the same time. It's not a fair fight. Your wife will win every single time. I mean, I don't know a single case that is not true, except when you get rid of your wife as well. And so if you remember what I said, you know, it emerges out of protest counterculture, what I call a social blob. That's a social blob theory that maybe you have heard some from the IC at this point. If you marry into the blob, your path to violence has been accelerated. If you marry outside the blob, your wife will make sure you'll get out of it. And so marriage is a two-edged sword. If you give them very radical wives, Malika Alarut, for instance, you are going to really hurry up on your, you know, towards your maker very fast. I mean, she already had that effect on at least two guys. So you can see that, yes, it's true, if you kind of marry them out, but even then, you know, the Saudis tried that, the Yemenis tried that, it's not as effective as we thought. You have to monitor very much who they hang out with, both online and offline. And by the way, the stuff about Abdulmutallab, it's from his own debriefs.
Lorenzo, did you have any further comments you want to make?
No, not really. If I'm okay. Just interjecting on the, I guess it's my Italian nature bringing people together, but I think they're both right, because there's no method to the madness. That's the beauty of studying these issues, where you can come up with 10 great cases and you have a pattern, but then you have that one case that sort of demolishes your castle. The idea is that, yes, before 9/11, I think, and two of the examples I mentioned when my presentations were pre-9/11, the guys I interviewed in the Hamburg cell, internet didn't play a big role. I mean, the Italian guys I met, I don't think I've seen a computer before, you know, maybe getting out of jail in 2005. But back in the 90s, it was just video cassettes, and that was it. So there was not even the option of the internet. I do agree with you that with some of the most serious people, it's not something that takes place online. But then we have the Abdulmutallab case, which is a very good counter.
And you have Major Hassan.
Yeah, but that's sort of, again, a different case in the sense that it's not really a plot, it's more of like one random guy in terms of from an operational point of view. So there's really no method to the madness, because you do have some guys who are sort of isolated, self-radicalized, everything takes place online, and online they do get that sort of connection that makes them become operational. I think that's the case for a lot of the German guys we're talking about. It starts with this online. The growth of German language media over the last few years has been staggering, you know, jihadi media. So they start in these German chat rooms, and then there's the connection that takes place. So it's really no one answer captures the reality. We have different, and that's so complicating in a way.
Okay. Before we open it up to some questions from the floor, perhaps another way to link these two positions together is that, as Marc has mentioned, there seems to be decreased lethality because of the training. And is this mainly because the training infrastructure is not there? But also, who are the trainers themselves? Are these people that have actually fought and therefore using some of their battlefield experience to train others? As Lorenzo talked, you know, you have this pipeline where people are split up, and based upon education or previous training, that kind of determines your, you know, for lack of a better word, military occupational specialty within either the foreign fighters or to train. So as we move forward, and as we are now 9 years into whatever you want to call the current operational environment, whether it be global war on terrorism or et cetera, do we risk possibility, is there a risk of other training areas being set up that would increase lethality? One of the cases we didn't discuss because it was a non-Western case was this incident where the Yemeni, or this former Saudi, basically turned himself in, said, I want to make things right, goes back to the kingdom, and a cell phone detonates an IED that was creatively placed in his body, shall we say, that really didn't have any effect on anybody but himself. So as we have this outflow from places like Iraq and Afghanistan, and physical space opens up, Lorenzo mentioned perhaps sub-Saharan Africa, do you see a correlation there between sort of what I call kind of geopolitical dead space or kind of ungoverned areas where, which could, if sort of left to metastasize, could this increase lethality of future attacks, both in those host countries or surrounding countries, and also against Western targets?
Well, let me kind of address some of that. In terms of training, you know, we have a tendency of looking at words and decontextualize them. You know, training in 2009, 2010 is very different from training in the 1990s. In the 1990s, you could train for a year and a half. You took 2-3 months course on bomb making, you know, and that was offered in Afghanistan. This is no longer the case. If you actually read the debriefs of the people that we have captured in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and in the West, who have undergone training in the last 5 years, it is really some guy who has pidgin Urdu, because he's often Uzbeki, doesn't speak any English, and if you're going to trust the mixture that you're making to some guy who's speaking pidgin Urdu, you have a lot of courage, which is why you have this communication back and forth. Is this right? Is this the formula right? I mean, that's how we kind of capture a lot of our guys in the West. So yes, the training has degraded, with some exceptions. Some of the exceptions are Yemen, because here you have true veterans of the Afghan war who were living happily in Saudi Arabia until 2004, 2005, and have migrated to Yemen. So, you know, I mean, your point is right. There is a link there to a foreign fighter. So those guys are pretty good. The other guys are not so good. The AQIM, they're not so good. I mean, their bombings, if you saw the bombings in Paris, it was a poor man's bomb, and it was really, I mean, 11 different plots. They killed only 12 people. That shows you how, you know, the lack of power of those devices. And, you know, they hadn't gotten better, with one exception about a year and a half ago when they blew up the UN building in Algiers. But that's the only exception. Everything else that you see from there is really kind of pretty bad. Now, in terms of trust, I agree. I think trust has become an issue. It was not an issue in the 1990s. In the 1990s, the only thing you had to go is really to the Taliban office in Quetta and say, I'd like to go to one of the camps. And they put you in a bus and, you know, send you to Kandahar from Quetta. This is what happened to the 9/11 guys. You know, basically, when after, you know, Slahi told them to come for, go to Quetta and not to go to Chechnya, they would never go. But now we have a very different environment. Now we have the drone attacks, extremely effective. Those guys are shaking their boots. Would you trust a Western guy who comes, hey, I like to join the jihad? Hell no. Which is one of the reasons why those guys went to three different groups. You know, because they didn't trust them. Even, you know, Shahzad, you know, the Times Square would-be bomber of May 1st of this year, he wanted to have training. They didn't trust him. Why didn't they trust him? Because he's son of Vice Air Marshal of the Pakistani Army. And so he had to have his old college roommate go through the training himself, become now part of TTP, Tehrik-e-Taliban in Pakistan, for Tehrik-e-Taliban in Pakistan finally to trust him because somebody was able to vouch for him. But that's during a time of very intense drone missile attack, where trust is now paramount, as opposed to the 90s, it was not. So, you know, you can see that you cannot decontextualize this. Things, conditions change all the time. Now, is a Maghreb going to be this type of sanctuary that, you know, we worry about? You know, I'm not so sure. One thing that you really need to, and that's where Pakistan is good, is that you really need to have good communication to other people. And it's really actually very hard to really get to the Sahara. I mean, what do? You walk, you drive. I mean, it's not the most, you know, available place to really go to. You know, you don't really have too many airplane. And if you actually land in Mauritania, in Niger, and so on, you're going to stand out like a sore. you're really going to stand out. So I'm not so sure that those are very good sanctuary places to go to. And I think Lorenzo is right. You know, many of the people attracted to the Sahel are, you know, kind of locals in a sense. You know, they have those ties to the Sahel. And it hasn't really, and you don't really have a hero yet in the Sahel that kind of would inspire young people outside the Sahel, you know, heroes, you know, that people want to emulate. You do have that in Somalia in some sense. You do have that, especially with Olaki in Yemen. And you still do have that in Pakistan and in Afghanistan, where you have those, and I agree with Clinton, that you have to deglorify those guys. You know, they're just punks. They're little criminals. You know, you can't really make them into heroes. I completely agree with you. But, you know, the heroism is still there in other places. It has not yet emerged from the Sahel. One thing you need to do is to make sure it never does, because that may become a source of inspiration.
Thank you. Why don't we open it up to Q&A? We've relocated the microphone, so please come up. Jeopardy rule still applies, and please identify yourself and any affiliation that you might have. We're open for questions.
We have a question from the web from Scott Douglas of the Naval War College. Okay. For Marc Sageman. He writes, you've hypothesized that except for the Islamic Jihad Union, the bleed-out issue seems low. Foreign fighters becoming terrorists. Where would you put the Fatah al-Islam case in Lebanon in this regard? Are they another exception, or is the conventional wisdom on this event wrong?
I don't recall a single Fatah al-Islam Western bombing or plot. I mean, they're important in Lebanon. They're important locally, but they're being decimated, I understand, in Lebanon. But I don't know.
There's a few Westerners in it. There's a couple of Danes, but
yeah, there's no plot
thing. I, I, of,
yeah.
Of course, PET keeps an eye on them because they go back and forth. But yeah, other than that, it's a local thing.
Okay.
Might change, but I don't know.
No, they're being decimated, so I'm not really sure it changed. If anything, they may disappear. Okay. But you never know. I mean, Middle Eastern politics, especially states around Israel, is very, very unpredictable, let's say.
Question, sir?
My name is Joe Fosewski. I'm Army Lieutenant Colonel, retired Civil Affairs. And I have a couple questions and a comment. I got back from Iraq from a year in Iraq a year ago. And maybe I'll give the questions first, and then give me a chance to make a comment. I'll sit down. One, talking about recruiting and random, and I agree with all of those things about either the fighters or the terrorists. But what is the common thread? What is the recruitment? What is it? I mean, they're all going there pretty much for one reason, to kill somebody, whether it's terrorism or fighting. What is this base thing that all these different kinds of people believe in or want to do it for? The comment we talked about getting married, that was not really a joke, but and it's really not for foreign fighters, but we had the Sunnis and Shias fighting each other, and there were some terrorists involved in that. And we would provide a means for the local sheikh to employ people, build a school, clinic, water treatment plant. And by and large, we paid several times what it would really cost to do it. But the idea was to employ all of the people that he had some sort of control over. And that evolved into the idea that it all revolved around sex, because if you paid the guy $300 a month, he got married, had a family, and relieved the tension, and he didn't shoot at you anymore. And it seemed to have worked for quite a while. So I kind of agree with the marriage part internally. Now, for terrorists, it's different. I agree with you on that. That might be a motivator to go out and kill more people.
Can I kick off? Sorry.
The last time we did a panel like this was about a year ago, and I told a very silly story about a blind journalist in Afghanistan. He interviews four guys, and he says, you know, why do you fight? One guy says, you know, it's all about jihad for me. You know, I want to be a martyr. I want to arise to heaven. You know, the other guy says, I come for the adventure. This is, you know, more exciting than anything that's ever been. I join for my brothers. I love fighting with the folks that are here. The third guy says, look, you know, I'm poor. I don't have any money. These guys offer me, you know, $30 a month. So I joined up. And, you know, the jihad and the brotherhood, that's all great too. I'll take that. And then the blind reporter turns to him and says, hey, by the way, I wasn't sure, are you American forces or are you terrorists? And so what I try and give you there is a framework to think about it. You know, for every recruitment dollar that's out there, you know, it's just like a labor economics equation. And I've actually tried modeling this with labor economics. And so, you know, it's pecuniary and non-pecuniary benefits. Al-Qaeda has their own, you know, recruitment contract that they sign, you know, which is pretty famous in the Harmony documents. You know, you get this much a month, so much vacation, you know, we'll take care of your family. So there are tangible benefits to joining too. And I think there are different combinations to that. There are some that join strictly for ideological reasons, you know, not for any sort of tangible reasons. So I think when you try and say, you know, why are they joining or why are they doing this, I think there's a host of reasons in there. I also think it's regionally based. And so something I hope comes up on the Somalia panel and the Yemen panel later on is one of my theories about Africa and why Al-Qaeda, in terms of long run, may not be able to recruit that well is because they spend a lot of time trying to buy access into groups. They actually pay out money to different tribes. They build out a lot of coalitions. And so it's that whole social norms versus market norms, you know. If we do it together because we're buddies and we're strong and we're fighting for an ideology, we tend to stick together longer. We see that in the Army. You know, people join for a lot of different reasons, but, you know, we come together as groups of, you know, soldiers and Air Force airmen and, you know, Marines to fight together. But when you rely strictly on market norms, which I don't want to talk about this too much because I know Ken Menkaus is going to be on this afternoon and he knows way more about this sort of stuff in Africa. I'm not sure that the ideology always transcends. It does for some, but not for all. And I think that's a weakness that's in there. So I think it's when we say, you know, why do people join to fight? It's a whole lot of different reasons, and it depends on the calculus. I think they join based on what their positions are, too. You know, the guy who joins to be the sort of prayer caller imam, he joins for ideological reasons. The guy who's the foot soldier that maybe doesn't really know what he's doing and conducts attack locally, he may be getting $30 a month, and he also likes being part of a group, and he was part of another rebel faction 2 weeks ago. So I think there's a lot of different dynamics in there which we can play to fracture it. The last thing on the marriage, you know, I mentioned the marriage program, and I obviously didn't go into enough detail about it, but the one example I am going to talk about is from Cairo and why I think it was successful in that place. And like Dr. Sageman said, it's probably not going to be something you want to use everywhere. I always have to be careful about what I say, and I wasn't careful enough, is when you do have options. You know, and Cairo, I think, is one of those interesting things. 5 years ago, everybody was saying, oh, Cairo is going to be crazy. There's going to be all sorts of incidents. And I haven't seen that actually happen there. I'm not saying the marriage program was part of that. But there were some different dynamics that play out of there situationally where there are more options for people to choose. And I'll shut up.
Steph?
I just wanted to add a couple points to that. I completely agree with Clint's analysis. Oh, by the way, I wanted to thank you for your service first. But I completely agree with Clint's analysis that trying to find one cause of why they're a foreign fighter phenomenon is foolhardy, just like we shouldn't look for one cause of terrorism. I mean, these are people mobilized for different reasons, and we should be more interested in trying to understand the process than trying to understand these monocausal factors. But there is something that we shouldn't underestimate. You asked for a common thread, and that is that all these people basically see there being the same problem, and they have the same diagnosis and the same solution. I mean, we still shouldn't, there is one difference between, you know, well, there are many differences, but the one difference I want to highlight between U.S. forces and foreign fighter groups is that these people are picking up and not fighting on behalf of a nation. They're fighting on behalf of other Muslims. They're always going to a war involving other Muslims because they believe they have a shared identity. And that's an amazing phenomenon that we see and we've seen throughout history in other religions and other places, but that's what we're seeing right now. And so although we shouldn't try to find one cause, we shouldn't underestimate the power of diagnosing a problem and having the same solution.
Marc or Lorenzo, did you have anything to add?
No, just don't underestimate the power of glory. A lot of those kids just want to do it for glory, even the losers who need the money. And by the way, that was true about Al-Qaeda paying people in the 90s. It is no longer true. Al-Qaeda has no money whatsoever. And if you look at the letters that have been released to the public, it's always, give us some money, we have nothing. So it's not really for financial reason, but I think glory is one of the major reasons running through both our military and the foreign fighters.
Lorenzo, did you have anything?
No.
Okay.
Sure.
Jay Jupiter, I'm a retired reservist, chief international law at U.S. Army Japan for a while. Dr. Sageman, I was wondering if there's any evidence of either the recruitment or use of foreign fighters as martyrs rather than fighters, or to the contrary?
Very much, and I may even defer to Clinton because I think he was at CTC. The foreigners in Iraq, especially, were just cannon fodder. They were just there to die, and that's one of the reasons we don't have much of a bleed out from Iraq, is that the foreigners were there to die, whether they were sent as fighters and so on. They really weren't fighters. They were there to die. So I think that we do have in Iraq. It's not the same thing in Afghanistan. We don't see it the same way in Somalia either. So again, you can't generalize from one place to another.
did we have anything from the web?
Yeah. Brian Fishman from the New America Foundation directs a question to Clint Watts. I appreciate your effort to provide a lens to understand foreign fighters by understanding ourselves, but there are differences that I'd like you to address, especially in the potential bleed-out threat to the West. First, the U.S. military is able to maintain discipline and commitment through extensive training and strict hierarchy. Such training is much more difficult for the jihadis, especially in Iraq and Afghanistan. If the answer is indoctrination, how do we disrupt that process on the ground in arenas of jihad? Second, is it really true that a foreign fighter who does not want to choose martyrdom necessarily aims to fight elsewhere? This seems strong to me. We have not seen tens of thousands, strange to me. We have not seen tens of thousands of Afghan Arabs fighting elsewhere. Where does ideology fit into this discussion?
Okay, I'll start with number one, which, can you just say part one again so I don't get them all mixed together?
The U.S. military is able to maintain discipline, but that training is more difficult for the jihadis. So if the answer is indoctrination, how do we disrupt that process on the ground?
I mentioned two things, specifically focusing on how we do messaging overseas. The first one is we focus on those actual cities. We know there are two dozen of them, I'm sure. Military intel folks know where all those locations primarily are. They'll account for 80% of the recruitment generally. In those, you focus on what the recruitment mechanisms are. There is no blanket solution to every single town. So this isn't, you know, we surge in Iraq, so we surge here, we surge here. We'll have to actually analyze each one of those nodes. I would focus on those people that are the most potential, are the most potent recruiters. And those are going to be, number one, former foreign fighters, and number two, probably family social relationships, which Dr. Sageman, you know, has talked about for years. Focus on those individuals, and you bring up those key issues. One, which is atrocities against other Muslims, which the militant ideology atlas, which we worked on at West Point, brought up, you know, four or five issues. Violence against other Muslims, violence against women and children, bring up those issues, which are already committing. What if you actually took someone, let's say, from one of the foreign fighter towns, you followed their route all the way to northern Iraq, where they actually conducted a suicide bombing. Instead, you had a journalist, let's say, from one of those countries that doesn't have access to northern Iraq, that actually goes and covers that story and tells that story of what actually happened, let's say, in Mosul, in that actual town where that foreign fighter recruit came from. That's probably a very different story and a different message they're getting about what they're doing when they leave. So that's one very key method I think that we have to focus on, because we're essentially looking to tarnish the image of those people that are actually going over there, such that it's not just glory, it's not just, you know, I'm fighting for my religion. It's actually, well, I got there and there's some great anecdotal evidence in both the Sinjar records and in New York Times recently. I got there and it wasn't at all what I thought it was. That's the second method. So I thought I was joining up with Al-Qaeda or whatever group it is, Al-Shabaab. I thought I was going to be fighting for this. I thought I was going to be fighting for that. And instead, I was sent to be a suicide bomber against a local warlord that the guy I fell under had some beef with. That's happened time and time again. That story doesn't get back to those recruiting locations either. So those are two things. What was the second part?
Is it really true that a foreign fighter who does not want to choose martyrdom necessarily aims to fight elsewhere?
No. And I if you read actually the third article I wrote called Countering Terrorism from the Second Foreign Fighter Glut, I put a chart in there where I try and show, like, hypothetically how this would work, where foreign fighters go, they learn what they're doing. Some of them are killed on the battlefield, gross numbers reduce. Some of them come back. Some of them retire. Some of them then don't retire, and they stay in the mix. The problem with the guys that don't retire is if they stay in the mix, what do you naturally do if you want to be, you know, part of a terrorist organization and you're out on your own and you're in a town in Yemen? Do you just sit and rally? No, you tend to recruit people. And there's several models of this. I'm using the Yemen Saudi sort of examples, but it's even happened here in the U.S. The Portland 7 case is another great example of that. Guy came back, he tried to kind of retire, didn't sort of work out. Over time, what happened? He radicalized 2, 3, 4, you know, 4 or 5. So the growth isn't, you know, massive on the scales of thousands. And a lot of foreign fighters that come back do retire. I think it was Bin Laden's brother-in-law is one of those classic examples. He's always on those National Geographic. He was killed later.
He's dead.
Yeah. You know, he came back and, you know, to his claims, he retired. You know, he fought there. But those guys also have an important role in the radicalization recruitment process, too. Just like every soldier that comes back to the U.S. doesn't necessarily sit and actively recruit, right? But what do they do? You know, I talk to my uncle. He was in the Army. He tells me about what he did there. I talk to my neighbor. He was in the Army. He tells me what. Those people are still in that social family connections there. And, you know, even though they aren't active in terms of getting jihad going, they're still part of the recruitment and radicalization process. I think that's very dependent, like I said, on where they're at. It's going to be – that's obviously not going to happen, I wouldn't think, here in Alexandria to the same extent that it's going to happen in, you know, Darna Libya or one of those other towns. I can't remember the third part, but Brian's talked to me before. So.
Good morning. My name is Reza Nassim John. I work for the Critical Threats Project at the American Enterprise Institute. My question is for Mr. Watts. You mentioned the ant trail, I guess, metaphor, where there are jihadis and recruiters who are sort of sending back the signals after they've established themselves. How much of this has become a focus for law enforcement and kinetic military efforts? And if this has, you know, how effective is it? And if it has been effective, how are the jihadis and recruiters reacting to it and changing their methodology, if at all?
I don't think it's actually happening. Like, they're saying this is what we're doing, but they're just getting a lot better at it. I think one of the stories that's not being told is how much our domestic and, you know, state, federal, local law enforcement have improved on terrorism. I think that's part of the trend that we're seeing now. They are picking up on those. This whole room right now is probably trolling on the internet trying to pick up those clues when we're not, you know, here at this conference. I don't know that it's been done in an organized fashion, but I like that model because, you know, as people drift to the internet, they tend to just provide you a ton more information. You know, just like restaurant guides on Yelp or anything, you know, I went to this place, it was great. You're seeing that phenomenon, I think, with these sort of foreign fighter networks as they get recruited. I went and talked to five people. This one was great. This guy was helpful. This guy's not. I think that in there's an analytical model we can use. I don't know that anybody's doing it yet, or maybe they are. I just don't know about it.
But you do think the fact that it's, you know, I guess because it's an ant trail, because it's people following a certain path, that it's an easier way to cut down a larger, you know, a larger flow of fighters, just because it's all concentrated between a couple of nodes?
Yeah, I like that model because we have approached it since 9/11, not everybody, but I know I did and a lot of people, in a very sort of systematic military, you know, process. Okay, where's our task org chart? You know, who's on top? How are they being recruited? Where are these people fanning out? And, you know, then we consistently start missing these nodes, you know, left and right. We've gotten better at it because we're starting to take in all the inputs. I like that model because it's a different way to think about it, which is we're all working, you know, sort of on our own. Whoever finds the best route, we're going to go with it. I think that's a good way to start examining another model to pick up on it, because the other one is very time intensive and doesn't always catch everybody.
Thank you.
Alan, do we have any further questions?
Hi, it's Angel Rabasa from the RAND Corporation, and I have an observation that I like the comments of the panel. And first, I'd like to commend the panel on very thought-provoking presentations, as would have been expected. The recruitment of foreign fighters from a European perspective, because I had been doing work on Europe, tends to be specific to the particular ethnic community that the fighters come from. So ethnic Pakistanis in the United Kingdom tend to go to fight in Kashmir or Afghanistan, and Somalis in Denmark are recruited to fight in Somalia. The exception tends to be the converts. And I have been struck by this phenomenon of the German Taliban Mujahideen going to Pakistan and establishing themselves. I don't know that there is an equivalent to that in any other European country. And they also, and this might support your point that they might not intend to come back, they tend to take their families. speaking of a family phenomenon, which is also quite remarkable. And in fact, in some of their recruitment pitches, they say that, you know, go to Pakistan and live in a pure Islamic country away from the vice and deprivation of the West. So I wonder if you could comment on this phenomenon of converts joining the fight in other places.
It's very simple. It's who your friends are. So, you know, if your friends are Pakistani or if they're Somali, you're going to go to that place. I mean, you just hang out. It's the social blob phenomenon, which also explains the geographical distribution. It's where the blobs are. You know, El Wed in Algeria, Derna in Libya, Tetouan in Morocco, and so on and so forth. The Germans are interesting because, they hang out with the Turks. So that's why they actually connected with IJU, which was a Turkic Uzbek group. Totally by chance. The linkage was first made by chance in Syria, in Damascus, by some Azeri of all places, who gave them the number, the contact with some guy in Pakistan. They went there. They were just creating at that point. The IJU was no more than 15 people. Now it's hundreds. Now that you've connected with the IJU, those guys kind of do send back, in a sense, what Clinton wanted to say before was bullshit messages, because in a sense that gives meaning to what they're doing. You know, so they say, oh, this is great, I'm doing jihad here and so on. And the reality is actually very different. And they are the ones who actually brought their family. This used to happen in the 1990s, with the Belgian, the French, and so on, where they actually brought their family to Afghanistan. That's where Malik al-Arud, of course, became famous. That's where Rabia Hutchinson, Australian woman who is more or less the head of that blob in Australia, got her reputation. But right now, things are very different because, again, there is no money. And so those guys have to fend off for themselves. And, you know, the kind of messages that you read even in Der Spiegel about the messages sent back from Pakistan to Germany, especially by the spouses, is really kind of it's a whole list of horrible things that are happening. There is no water and so on. And, you know, that goes very much with, you know, what Clinton is trying to do, and I completely agree. Namely, you de-glamorize this. You know, going to Pakistan, you know, means hiding in a safe house where you kind of shift from week to week to week to another one, not really making connections, sometimes waiting 8 months to even make connection with one guy who's going to say, you know what, I don't trust you. No, I'm not going to take you on. And so you see, this is the reality of the place. And not only that, if you weigh them on the way to the airplane and you weigh them when they captured or when they come back, they are skeletons by the time they come back, because fighting jihad is really diarrhea. That's what people, you know, always have. It is very unsanitary. People are sick. They develop hepatitis. They develop malaria. I mean, this is a reality of the situation. That's what needs to be broadcast to the potential folks who, you know, are attracted with the glory of doing jihad. It is not that glorious. It really isn't. So the convert phenomenon is very simple. You know, it's usually a bunch of guys, and they go together. It's not just one guy deciding, and they'll go where they're known. So the first guy who makes a connection, he has, in a sense, a market advantage, to use, you know, Clinton's economic analogy. I don't like the pheromones, so it's not like he's laying down tracks pheromones. It's more of a market analogy. It's communication. That's exactly right. And therefore, now the German converts go with IJU, which is kind of, you know, it's a head scratcher. in a sense. Why would they go? That's because of the connection of the Turks and the first connection that was made.
I might elaborate a bit on the German. Yes, it is through connections, but in a way, what is so coincidental about Germany is that you have three different clusters, one out of Berlin, one out of Hamburg, the old Al-Quds Mosque, and now closed down, renamed and then closed down, and one in Bavaria, the Munich Neu-Ulm area.
Neu-Ulm.
And for different reasons, those three clusters sort of ended up in the region, in Pakistan. My understanding is that they ended up separately. Yes, there's the Turkish link, but for example, the new Hamburg cell, was 15, 20, 25, not sure. People that left Hamburg had no connections to the Berlin and the Bavarian people. And it was a very multi-ethnic cell, actually. It wasn't just Turks and converts. The new Hamburg cell had a lot of Chechens, had a lot of Arabs, I believe also Somali, so different. They all ended up going there. The other interesting thing is the aspect of the family, of bringing the children, of creating this sort of new bucolic jihadi environment where you can live as a true Muslim. That is not exactly unique. There are some, we're talking about very isolated cases, but it's not unique in Europe. We've seen other cases. The reason why I was talking about, for example, about sub-Saharan Africa being potentially a new place, because we've seen cases of people from Northern Europe buying war, clearly in, let's say, radical Salafist, close to jihadi circles, buying land in these countries and moving there with families. We've seen even examples, there was an example in France, where a small group of families bought a couple of houses in a small town near the Spanish border and tried to establish sort of a commune. So we've seen these cases. What is, and we've seen about a few cases in Yemen as well, of Europeans going there. What is unique is that in the German case, they've chosen, or maybe they ended up for the reasons we mentioned, in Pakistan, in an area where, of course, you have not the connections you can make in Nigeria, but those that you make in Waziristan. So a completely different scenario. And that's what makes it more troubling. Some of them probably are not coming back. Some of them are going to get killed, as has been the case. But there are indications that some of them have been at least going back and forth with Germany and Pakistan. So that's what makes it really, really troubling.
Okay, well, I'm afraid we've run out of time here. Lunch is available over to this side of the room. We're going to be starting back up at 1:15. So please join me in thanking our panel here. I think it was a very informative and interesting discussion.
Yeah. Oh, just a moment. What's the visiting center?